Today, we're going to be talking about an Adam Sandler movie that you might have forgotten. It has family. It has television time-traveling devices. It has far, far too many domestic disputes for a comedy. Just uncomfortably long arguments between a husband and a wife. Will this movie make you laugh? Maybe. But most importantly, this movie will leave you saying, why? Today, we're going to be talking about Click, the Adam Sandler movie. In this story, we follow Adam Sandler's character, Michael Newman, a hardworking architect who's trying to find the balance between both work and family. Michael is your typical busy businessman who can't seem to get enough time to do anything. Oh, I wonder how that's gonna get fixed. His boss, played by David Hasselhoff, is he's a dick, is the best way I would say it. But it's David Hasselhoff, so he's kind of charismatic about it in a weird way.
Let's just take out the atrium and run with that, and there's your drink.
So instead of going to his son's swim meet, he's stuck at work with these men.
I meant no disrespect, Prince Hubbada Hubbada.
Hubba Bubba.
Habibu!
And by the time he actually makes it to the swim meet, it is far too late. The Speedo guy is definitely going to have sex with Michael's wife. There is no denying that. After the swim meet, you would think that Michael would try to make up for the lost time he got with his son. He missed the swim meet. You think in the post ice cream barbecue, I don't really know what's going on here. He tried to be more active and participate more. Nope. He's on the phone with his boss the entire time, while for some reason there are just teenagers firing what I can only assume to be cannons.
Like a signature building we're talking about.
Those are just the loudest firecrackers I have ever heard in my entire life. And Michael seems to be the only person upset by this. By these people just firing firecrackers. Everyone else is having their ice cream. And Michael decides to then jump the fence and threaten both them and their fathers.
Even Grandpa!
You dead.
Oh shit!
Now you better run! I kicked your father's ass in high school and now I'm gonna kick yours!
Imagine hearing a person in hot pursuit behind you, threatening your whole family lineage, and it's Adam Sandler. To me, it just seemed like they didn't know how to end this scene, so they just told him to go up and chase the kids away. In the next scene, Adam begins to argue with his wife, one of the many, many, many marital arguments that happened in this, and I cannot stress this enough, comedy.
Are you kidding me?
Does he not know what a television remote looks like? That's clearly like an RC remote, right? I don't know why they don't label them. I don't know why he decides to throw some rampage and go off to Bed Bath & Beyond. And when Michael shows up to this Bed Bath & Beyond, he's freaking unhinged. He's threatening associates. He's laying in bed with his shoes on. He's having an existential crisis.
So tired of my life.
Oh no, what's this? Is this progression of the plots? To me, it just seems like the plot is so force throughout the entire movie. They don't know how to get from one scene to another sometimes. They have Michael go to Bed Bath & Beyond for some reason, which they don't sell TV remotes there. They don't sell television remotes at Bed Bath & Beyond. I googled. I got Darth Vader Snuggies. The only Beyond stuff is the as seen on television, not this weird room that he now decides to enter. As he enters the Beyond section, he is greeted by the mad scientist, the legend, the absolutely wonderful Morty, played by Christopher Walken. So during this conversation with Morty, Michael wonders if there are any universal remotes in this section. And Morty's like, oh, I have just the remote for you. Come with me. And Morty hands him a remote, which, as we all know, based off the premise of this movie, is a remote that can control time. And he just is like, here, take it. Have this godly power just straight to a stranger. How he has no read on Michael's character. He could be like a pedophile. You don't want Time Lord pedophiles. That would be pandemonium. The reasoning he gave is because good guys need a break every once in a while. This isn't a carton of cigarettes, Morty. This is a remote that can control the universe. And you're just handing it out to strangers. Could Adam Sandler not find a better way to introduce a time-traveling remote than going to Bed Bath & Beyond? So, going forward a little bit, his wife comes down, wants to talk about how they can't go on this camping trip that he promised his kids. And Michael decides, you know what, I'm going to give my argument, and he pauses the television. And unbeknownst to him, he paused reality and his wife as well. And he had no idea what he had done. And it wasn't until his dog was barking while he was trying to work. And you know what? How you do whenever your dog is barking. You just pick up your television remote and try to turn the volume down. And it worked. Which, to me, seems like just a gross, horrible way to progress the plot. Not in like a, yeah, like gross like that. I mean, gross as in, ew, why couldn't you write it better? Let's say he drops the remote. I don't know. So he realizes that he can mute his dog now. So he lets the dog out, and he wants to play with the remote a little bit. Dog's peeing, taking too long, and he decides to press the fast forward button, and the dog begins to fast forward through time. Everything else seems to be moving at a steady flow along with Michael. Just the dog is moving forward, which begs the question, how the hell does that work? Hi, welcome to Nathan's Science Void, the dark void where I tell you about science. Today's topic is time. You see, time just keeps going. There's no stopping this bad boy. It's time. There are multiple theories about time, but that's all boring mumbo jumbo that we don't even know. Today, we're going to talk about how Adam Sandler thinks time works. As we see in the scene right here, Adam Sandler is fast-forwarding his dog into the future and somehow bringing that future into the present. Which would mean that time in this universe works kind of like there is a base timeline where I guess Adam Sandler sits. He's the anchor of time. And everyone else's timeline just sort of is floating above it, just sort of doing their own thing, living their own life, having a little bit of fun, if you ask me, which could cause some serious issues. Like, for instance, let's say you're having a conversation with somebody, or any sort of thing that requires more than one person. Could you fast forward that one person through the conversation? Or would everyone involved with an interaction be roped into it? But then wouldn't everybody be roped into every interaction if you believe that everything in time is kind of entwined? And could Adam Sandler kill somebody with this power? Could he point the remote, fast forward the person through their entire life, and then they die? Could he do that? Is he able to fight God? Is Adam Sandler a god? Could he make time itself collapse? The next morning, Michael heads back to Bed Bath & Beyond, where he meets Morty again. He's curious about his newfound powers that he's been given. And Morty begins to demonstrate how to use the remote, the functions of it, the features. Michael begins to travel through various points in his history.
Oh, Teddy.
Is that my parents? They're making you.
No! My mother's vagina!
Yuck. there's so many points in this movie that make me wonder, hey, why? Why did you do this? They even show Adam Sandler as a young kid, a young football player. He's camping with his family. The scene, however, was really heartwarming. We got to see some insight on Michael's childhood and sort of what drives him to give his kids a different life than he had. So it was a heartwarming scene. It was nice. I liked it. I'm starting to think that maybe this movie has a little bit of heart to it.
No, Linda. I think, Stacy, it's the most beautiful feet of water.
Oh, what the hell? What? You're telling me you're gonna go from this heartwarming scene to this weird, pervy foot contest with David Hasselhoff? Does this movie know what it wants to be? Is it trying to be a family movie? Is it trying to be a comedy? Is it softcore porn? I don't know what it is. Moving on, we don't need to talk about this scene anymore. It was unnecessary, unwarranted, and uncomfortable. So now we are at Michael's house. No more foot contests. And now Michael, his parents, kids, they're all going to have dinner together. However, as usual, Michael has to work. So what does he do? Wait. Did he just erase his family from existence? I get you needed to get work done, but holy shit. Is Adam Sandler Thanos? Is he some kind of stand user?
Cool. I can skip chapters.
Oh. Okay, how does that work? Because either he was gone during that, or he was just not sentient at all. So, was he sitting at the dinner table just... So, as he skips a few chapters, Michael finds himself in the basement, where he's saying goodbye to his parents. After that, Michael heads downstairs to be greeted by Morty, who is at his door.
Hello, Michael.
And Morty begins to clean up sort of some of the confusion in that whenever you fast forward or skip through time, from that point to when you become, I guess, sentient again, you are on autopilot. Michael is there, but he's not really there.
The lights are on, but nobody's home. Mm.
Real quick, I couldn't ignore this because, hey, it's Terry Crews. If there's any scene with Terry Crews in it, I can't skip it. So Michael enters his office where he is, where him and the entire company, they are doing a meeting on sexual harassment. And during that meeting, Michael with the remote is able to distort reality for his eyes only, it seems. No one else can see his boss looking dummy thick. This segues into the big meeting that Michael has been preparing for. He's been working for this meeting for what it seems to be, I don't know, weeks, months? I'm not quite sure. So he goes to the meeting, he presents it to these businessmen, and turns out they don't like it.
These morons are so boring, they make me want to take a sword and chop my own dick off.
And that hotel design? I'd like to rip it up. I think that egghead watched a bad documentary on Asian architecture.
When they come back, he reverses his pitch to more be in favor of what they think the building should be. So Michael wins them over, and we get this.
Fuck yeah!
There it is. The one and only F word, you get a PG-13 movie. After winning over the businessmen, Michael's boss emits a noise that borders on both pleasure and confusion. And I hate it. It plays in my head constantly. So here it is. Excited with the news that Michael has now become a partner of his boss, he goes home with gifts to give to his kids, and they lose their minds.
Get him.
You would have thought they saw the face of God. Everything is good and great, right? Wrong. Everything is bad. Everything is really, really bad. Because do you want to know why? When Michael goes to the office in the morning, he finds out that he hasn't been promoted yet. Not only does he have to land the gig, he also has to be able to finish it in order to become the partner, which could take, it could take months. It could take, he estimated, it could take upwards of 3 months. Filled with rage, Michael decides to just... And once again, I guess they just didn't know how to end this scene, so they just did this.
Partner-wise, I taste shit.
You do?
Stacy, did you put shit in my lunch? Oh!
I'm gonna get going now, sir.
Oh, Stacy!
It seems as if they're trying to hit a quota of jokes per scene. They're trying to get that heart in there, that little bit of you feel something, you feel bad for the character, but it's still a comedy. So they're like, okay, we have to find a way to make this funny in the end. Adam farting his face. And this right here is where the plot starts to thicken. Because Michael goes to Morty, he wants to ask, how far can he jump? Would it be possible to jump a week? A month? Or maybe 3 months? However, Morty warns him against it. Morty says, that's not a good idea, Michael. You really shouldn't jump that far. It could really get dangerous. And Michael trusts him. He says, okay, fine, whatever. He's not happy with the answer he's given. But he trusts him. And he doesn't do it. Yet. Hard at work, Michael is pushing pencil to paper, really trying to grind out this project. His kids, who, have I mentioned, are just the cutest, came up with their own architecture design. And Michael decides to just shit on their dreams.
Ceiling's too high, the hallway's too narrow.
Next. What is yours made of?
Pickles!
What an absolute piece of poop. His wife comes down, she's like, what the hell's wrong with you? And yeah, I think anybody would say that. Freaking scratching out their kid's design. Fed up, Michael decides, you know what, I've had it. When his wife goes upstairs, he grabs the remote and says, take me to my promotion. And he clicks it. And all is well. He is now at his promotion. He's like, yes. I fast forward 3 months. However, as he begins to find out more information, not only has it been a whole year, but Michael is now in couples therapy. When he gets home, out of the shadows comes Morty, who can probably figured out, hey, Michael seems a little bit different than he has been for the last year. I think he might have jumped a whole year. So the way the remote works is it takes all your previous skips and it programs it to say, hey, I'll skip those from now until forever. Michael's like, no, I've had it with this device. I don't want to be a part of this anymore. And he tries to destroy it. And that's when we get the remote destruction sequence.
No. Oh, don't be mean.
Whoa! Are you just happy?
Back to the it programs certain things. I understand it skips an argument because there's been multiple arguments. So he skipped his dog peeing. Does that mean that every time his dog pees, he'll fast forward a little bit? That the consistency of this movie is not good. So with this new knowledge of the remote, Michael lives his life very cautiously. He doesn't shower. He doesn't change. He doesn't even talk to his wife for the fear of them just arguing, which that's not a good way to live. When Michael arrives at work, his boss kind of drops a bit of a bombshell on him. That's he's moving to Morocco. He wants Michael to be the number two or the head of international sales. However, he has previously fast-forwarded through a promotion, which means...
No! I don't want a promotion! No!
Now, It has been 10 years. And Michael seems to have gotten everything he has ever wanted. He's now the CEO. He's got a cool Stark Tower-like house, hotel. He's now morbidly obese.
Oh, what is this? I got titties. I got juicy titties.
Yeah, I didn't like that. Michael heads back home and does what any person would do after they haven't seen their family for 10 years. Call your son fat.
You're enormous. Look who's talking, Captain Twinkie the SS fat ass.
And then comment on your daughter's body.
Samantha?
When did you get boobs?
That's some real cringe right there. And then the biggest bombshell of the movie happens.
What's going on?
I fucking called it. I knew it. I called it. I called it. I knew it. So what does Michael do with this unwanted reality dropped upon his lap? Michael then fast forwards another 6 years. Turns out he's skinny again. However, he had just recovered from cancer. When he leaves, he runs into his son again, who is also skinny and no longer Jonah Hill. They go back to the office. Ben is now an architect, which, you know, that's pretty cool.
That's a looker.
No.
Blondie,
no, don't.
Big lips.
Don't. Please don't Jessie, say it.
What? Is that your girl?
Oh, for the love of God, don't say it.
No, that's your daughter, Samantha.
Ah! That hurt. Turns out that Michael's dad is now dead, and he didn't get to say goodbye. In fact, when he went to rewind, he couldn't even go to the funeral because he wasn't there. And Michael decides to go to the last point that he saw him, which this scene actually kind of got to me a little bit. It was pretty sad. I'm not gonna lie to you all. It was a pretty sad scene.
How you do the stupid trick? I've always known. Can you let me do my work?
It seems that Michael's divorce isn't the only bombshell that's going to be dropped in the second half of this movie. It seems that Morty is the Angel of Death. Yes, Morty, the mad scientist, is also the Grim Reaper. Didn't really see that coming, to be honest. Michael asks to go to a good place, and when he presses fast forward, he ends up at his son's wedding, where he is immediately prompted to give a toast. During the wedding, Donna and Michael's song came on, they danced, it was super sweet. And then Michael's daughter, who I forget her name, calls Speedo Guy dad, and then Michael has a heart attack. And it's super crazy, everyone's freaking out because, rightfully so, someone's having a heart attack. However, the band is still playing their song. Someone is dying. Stop the set. Hey, maybe don't play while someone's dying. An important member of the family is dying, and you're still just singing along. Heck yeah. So after that chaos, Michael finds himself in the hospital with his kids, who, you know, they're telling them, hey, Ben's like, I gotta leave, but hey, yeah, it was nice seeing you.
36 hours straight.
And then he leaves, and then Michael's like, no, I gotta see him again. I gotta do it. I gotta prove my point. I gotta be a good dad. Well, as Michael leaves, he murders a nurse, and this leads to the infamous scene that I talked about in last week's video. This is a comedy. This is an Adam Sandler comedy.
Family comes first.
That was terrible ADR. The dubbing on that was atrocious.
Forever and ever, babe.
I get this is a sad moment, but dude, you are remarried. You should not be calling your ex-husband babe, especially when your current husband is like right there. I'm kidding. I regret to inform you that I have to retcon something that I said in last week's video, which you all have watched, correct? I said that this is how the movie ended. However, that's not how the movie ended, but how fucked up would that be if the movie just ended with Adam Sandler dying? But turns out this is how it ends. It was all just a dream. Or time reset. I don't know. So filled with excitement and his life didn't end, Michael leaps out of the bed, dances with the associate, who I can only assume thinks Michael is just cracked out of his mind, goes home, celebrates with his new life, he goes to his parents' house earlier, wakes them up, freaks them out, all was well, Michael had changed his life, Ebenezer Scrooge had been reformed, he heads into the kitchen. And he sees the remote.
Like I said, good guys need a break. I know you'll do the right thing this time. Love, Morty.
Remote destruction sequence! I mean, would I watch it again? Not by myself. Certainly not for a video. This has taken a while to record. I'm sorry this video is going to be a fucking tank of a video. But there's a lot of points that I wanted to hit. So thank you for making it this far. And, you know, if you like what I do on this channel, and you want to support this channel, subscribe to become a kinky peer. We're the kinkiest army out there. It's just the way it is. This video took a while, and it really... means a lot for you to leave a like. It's like, hey, I like what you did. It was pretty cool. And I will see you all next week.